My name's Fiona Croxford, and for the next 45 minutes, I'll be speaking with some amazing guests about how to make kids' bedtime stories more diverse, more equal, and less sexist. The aim of the class is for us all to get better at storytelling. Our expert guests know all about rewriting the script because they've been doing just that. Let me introduce them. First up, we have Francesca Cavallo. Francesca is an Italian best-selling author, activist, and entrepreneur. She's a co-creator of the hugely successful series Midnight Stories for Rebel Girls, which has sold millions of copies around the world and been translated into more than 40 languages. She's also recently started a publishing company called Undercats to promote and celebrate diversity. And we're also joined by Ruth. Ruth, lovely to meet you again. Ruth is an author and illustrator from Zambia who goes by the pen name Lutay. She started writing and publishing short stories after struggling to find diverse texts to read with her kids. Later on in this session, we'll also be joined by one of our 100 women, Nadine Kaadan, who'll be giving us some tips on how to choose more diverse literature. But firstly, to kick off the session, Francesca, what does it mean to rewrite the script and why do we need to do that?
Sometimes when we, well, first of all, let me start by saying that I'm really happy to be with you and to join this conversation, because I think that conversations like these have a huge impact in the way we see the world. And when we see it differently, we can change it. One of the problems with storytelling for children is that sometimes people look at books like Goodnight Stories for Rebel Girls or look at books that feature characters of color or characters with disabilities. There are very few books about these different characters, and they consider these books ideological. That is one of the most frequently made objections to a narrative that changes the paradigm of children's books that don't feature only female characters who want to be princesses and feature female characters who want to be, who want to have professional aspirations. But the problem is actually that the books that we currently have are the ideological ones, because instead of portraying the world in all of its diversity, they make a very deliberate choice in making, in marginalizing stories that don't fit the traditional narrative of the prince that wants to marry the princess, of the male character that is the one with all the action, of the white character that has the absolute protagonism of the story. Those stories that marginalize the stories of all characters with disabilities, that marginalize the stories of all female characters, that marginalize the story of people of color, it's those stories that portray the world in a way that is very far from the world as it is. So they choose a perspective, and they instill in kids the idea that there is a default way of being human, and that that default way is being white, male, heterosexual, and able-bodied. And so these kind of books that are emerging, where, like Rebel Girls and like other books, are actually starting to portray the world in all of its diversity, and they are helping children develop an understanding that there are many ways to come into the world, that there are many body types that you come into the world in, and that there is not a right and wrong way to be human. There's just humanity. So that is the fight that we are fighting. We're actually trying to show the kids that the world is very diverse as it is, that there are no right ways to be human, and that you can actually embrace that diversity and feel rich when there is diversity around you. And by doing so, I believe that we are eradicating those beliefs that can turn, when we grow up, into sexism, into misogyny, into racism, and into ableism.
Some of the stories I was told as a kid, they often centered around helpless damsels in distress being saved, often by charming princes. But before we get into that, I want to invite everyone watching to join in the conversation. Just say you can send in your questions to us over the BBC 100 Facebook, Twitter, or Facebook, Twitter, or YouTube accounts. There are so many of them, as well as comment on the live stream on the BBC World Service YouTube channel. Yeah, we'll put your questions to our guests live during the session. But just to pick up on that a little bit more, Francesca, you were talking about those sort of traditional box ticking and sort of, I guess, default narratives. Can you explain a little bit more about how you went about writing goodnight stories for Rebel Girls and the motivation behind that?
Sure. When my co-author, Elena Favilli, and I started working on Goodnight Stories for Rebel Girls, what we did was we reflected upon our experience. We were both avid readers as children, and we could not remember any books that we had read when we were kids that portrayed women, female characters, into the roles that we liked to play. For myself, I liked to be a knight. For example, whenever I was playing with my cousins, I come from a very stereotypical Southern Italian family. We grew up, we were seven girls. And whenever we played, I always took male roles because I felt that female roles were not exciting. And I felt that the only way to have exciting roles when I was playing with my cousins was to be a male character. So I always wanted to be a knight. I always wanted to be a prince. I always wanted to be the dad in a family. And that stayed with me. Of course, you know, you grow out of those games, but that sort of that profound belief that you need to be different from what you are in order to make exciting things with your life, it stays with you. And when we started working on Goodnight Stories for Rebel Girls, Elena and I wanted to disrupt that belief. We wanted to change that for the girls that came after us. And we decided to create a collection of bedtime stories that celebrated the work of women. So this was something that we really cared about because we didn't want to make a fictional tale of women, because we felt that in the moment in time we were in, it mattered to tell kids that these are not fictional stories. These women did these things, these very exciting things in real life, and they actually did change the world. And it was also a little bit to provoke reflection upon the fact that when we study in school, the vast majority of the history that we studied in philosophy, poetry, anything, it appears as if the world had been made by men. And the reason is that we're not trained as a society to celebrate the accomplishments of women as much as we celebrate the accomplishments of men. We wanted to change that and to actually make that reflection part of the nightly routine of families around the world. And that's why we decided to write those stories as bedtime stories, so that our dream was, and it became true, luckily, that so many millions of families around the world could meditate every night on the accomplishments of women. And one of the most amazing moments in the promotion of Goodnight Stories for Rebel Girls was during this presentation in Milan, where there was a lot of people, and the presenter invited kids to sit in the front row. And one of them, we were about to start the presentation, and one of them stood up with the book open on the first page of the first volume. It was the page of Ada Lovelace. And he stood up in front of everyone. It was like hundreds of people. And he said, showing the illustration to everyone, "My mom did this." He was the son of one of the 60 artists who illustrated the book. And that moment where he showed the work of his mom so proudly to an audience of hundreds of people was a moment that I will forever cherish, because still today, when we see working moms in TV shows, in animated shows, in books for children, a lot of times we see the children feeling neglected. It's very rare that we see the kids feeling lucky, feeling proud of their mother's work. And for me, that moment was one moment when I felt, well, we did it, because for this child, at least, this is an opportunity to be proud and to show off the work of his mom to the world.
Thank you for that. And Ruth, picking up a little bit on what Francesca was saying, what types of stories were you told as a child and how did they influence your storytelling?
Thank you so much, first of all, for having me here. And yeah, it's a great question. I think growing up, all the stories I read were written elsewhere, so they weren't necessarily representative of my heritage or, you know, the things, the environment around me. So it was very much holding up a window to somebody else's story and reflecting on other people's lives. So this has been one of the main influences for my writing, especially now that I'm a mom of two boys, especially living in the UK. I just felt it was imperative that I contributed to this narrative as well and write stories that are reflective of my experience, their heritage, the faith, our faith, and also the type of, you know, character development elements that I want to see in books, you know, being highlighted. So not so much from my own experience, which is why I want to build that for my son. So the stories I'm writing, stories that are going to be elevating the role of women, highlighting equality between men and women. So the very first book I wrote, which is called My Mommy Has Many Jobs, does exactly that. So it celebrates women, motherhood especially. So we don't often come across books that, you know, glorify motherhood in the way that they do when you see a man actually taking up his role as a parent. So I wrote this book to kind of illustrate that, you know, a mother's work can be just as valuable as any other work. So they are quite often our very first teachers, they are our first educators. Like nurses, they look after us when we're unwell. Like chefs, they prepare food for us. So it's a very poetic play on the role of a mother, and which is just perfect for a little child. So I've been reading this book since my son was two, he's four now. And I just love it when he talks about his mommy having many jobs and the impact of that in growing up, is that he's going to be able to see women and roles that are associated with women and motherhood in a positive light. So yes, that was one of the key influences in me writing. And especially here in the UK, a recent study has actually shown that only 5% of the books that are written have a lead character who's either Black, Asian, or from a minority ethnic group. So another reason why I'm writing these books to share with my children and, you know, with friends and the wider community is so that I can provide more books that other kids can hold up as mirrors, see themselves reflected in those stories. This is in huge contrast, for example, to 33.5% of, you know, primary school children who are actually from, you know, Black, Asian, and ethnic minority backgrounds. So if the library books don't actually reflect that, then there's a huge problem. I think there's a massive gap that we can fill. And my personal contribution is in just doing that. So if I want to see these stories, I think I'm the only person that can actually write them, or someone like me can write them so that it's authentic, it's my voice, and I can kind of drive the narrative and, you know, influence some positive elements that way too.
I mean, those were some really, really shocking statistics. What advice, Ruth, would you give to people watching who might want to write and create their own new diverse characters? What should they keep in mind?
Absolutely. So, I mean, there's various things you can do. I mean, not everybody can be a writer, but absolutely, writing is a great start. Like, as you can see, there's a huge, huge gap there. So we want more writers, more diverse writers, more authentic voices. So please, if you have a calling to write and share your stories, just do it. There's so many ways to get your books out there now. I've published my own books independently, and, you know, I've been able to market myself through friends and family and my local community, and so that's one way you can go about it. Other things that you can try to do, very simple things such as the language that you're using around your children at home, like this is going to be the voice that they grow up with, so making sure that that's positive. Being aware of the words that other people are speaking over your children and being able to step in so that you can, you know, correct accordingly. Making sure that you're exposing your children to diverse, you know, literature, diverse content, diverse friendships, you know, experience life in its beautiful, diverse, you know, character. And that's going to help you develop more understanding of others and appreciation of the world as we see it. You know, it's diverse in its natural state. Other things that you might want to do is to make institutions accountable. So speak to your local libraries, get in touch with your local schools, ask them about what they're doing to make sure that the content that they're making available to children is both diverse and inclusive. So that's something you can do as well. affirmation cards for your children. Be, make sure that you instill a very strong identity for your children, that if somebody else outside of your, you know, environment tells them that there's something that they're not, or there's something negative, they won't believe it because they know within themselves that they're valuable. They don't have to, you know, see it displayed elsewhere. They know within them that that they're noble. So yeah, that can instill a lot of confidence as well. So that's just a few suggestions. So hopefully there's something for everyone there.
And Francesca, while we're still on the topic of racial diversity, this year your publishing company, Undercats, released Dr. Lee and the Crown-Wearing Virus. It tells the story of the Chinese doctor who was based in Wuhan, who first blew the whistle about the threat of coronavirus and the rate it was spreading. Why was it important to tell his story?
What we have assisted, especially in the United States during this pandemic, has been a rhetoric that was very charged with xenophobia. So one of my concerns from the very beginning of this pandemic was the surge of anti-Asian racism that was caused by a number of reasons, but certainly it didn't help that Trump constantly talked about a Chinese virus and about the Kung Flu and about all these racist stereotypes. And let's remember that this is a very traumatic event in the life of millions of children around the world. And this sort of rhetoric, so inflammatory, risks to create an association in these children between the face of an Asian looking person, of an Asian person, and the virus, one of the events that will define as, you know, their childhood. And these sort of things are very, very hard to spot at the very beginning, but that they can easily turn into a very profound racist sentiment when one grows up. So one of the reasons why, when I started thinking, what could I write about coronavirus? What could I write to help children have a sense of what is happening? I wanted to break this association between the virus and the face of an Asian person. And so that's why I chose to replace that association with the association with the first hero of this pandemic, Dr. Li Wenliang, who was the first doctor to blow the whistle and to tell everyone that there was a new virus that was spreading in Wuhan. And the book, thanks to his example, he was threatened by the police, and he still gave a lot of interviews, and he was responsible for putting the word out that the new virus was spreading in Wuhan. Thanks to his example, the book celebrates the courage of doing the right thing, even when it's hard, even when it's difficult. And I turn him into a hero. The co-protagonist of the book is a girl, a 7-year-old girl. Her name is May, and she lives in the United States. And Dr. Lee becomes, for her, a role model to help her find a way to help out her community in the course of the pandemic. And I think that when it comes to the communication with children about this crisis that we're going through, unfortunately, the vast majority of the communication with kids revolves around safety measures like wash your hands or wear a mask or, you know, all these little tips that are very, very important. But those are not the things that we look for when we look at the news about coronavirus. If we look at all the coverage that we see and all the content that we consume every day about coronavirus, what we're looking for is a feeling that we sort of understand more or less where this story is going. And that is a way for us to cope with the anxiety that is provoked by this emergency that we're going through. Children don't have any of that. Because if we just, you know, every time they ask, if we just keep telling them that they have to wash their hands, we're not taking into account the fact that they need to know a little bit more about what is going on, that we need to find a way to make them feel connected to this global story that we are living through. And that is why I wrote Dr. Lee and the Crown Wearing Virus, and I received this feedback the other day about this child. There are many children that are very scared about the virus, and they are developing a real phobia about what's going on, because of course they, you know, they don't want to feel responsible for their grandparents getting sick. And there was this little girl, 8-year-old, that was so scared of the virus, and she read the book, and her mom told me that she went to sleep hugging the book with Dr. Lee in it. And that is usually what I go for. I want the books to sort of inform the children about what is going on, but also to give them comfort that they will be able to get through this, and that they can, in the meanwhile, be there for their family and be there for their community.
No, it seems like a very, very important way into lots of difficult conversations this year with the pandemic, loss, children having to, study from home, not seeing their friends. But also we had so many anti-racism protests as well. So there's been lots of difficult discussions around race and health this year. But before we get into that, I want to invite Nadine Kaadan, one of this year's 100 women, into the conversation. Welcome, Nadine. Nadine is an author and illustrator from Syria who now lives in London. She's worked with many young refugees affected by post-conflict trauma, and many of her books reflect her country's difficult history. She's been giving us some tips on how to make, on how to choose more diverse literature. Let's have a watch.
My name is Nadine Kaadan. I am a Syrian children's book author and illustrator. I moved to London because of the war. I would like to share with you some tips on what to think about when choosing a book. Firstly, I would like to urge everyone who has kids to ask themselves how culturally and ethnically diverse their book collection is. I truly believe that the end of racism starts on the bookshelves. Equality starts at home. Now, the problem is, if you go to the major and the large bookshops, it's not easy to find books and characters of cultural diversity. Therefore, you might want to seek out independent publishers, independent bookshops. There, you might find more inclusion. Ask yourself, who are the protagonists in the story? Are the diverse characters kept in the background, waiting for others to help them, or do they have agency? There is a fine line between pity and empathy. If you're looking for literature about a specific country or a specific culture, seek out help from people who have true understanding of that culture and deep understanding of that country. You might want to even look out for authors who come from that culture, that they're talking about their own experiences with their own voices. I truly believe like this we can avoid negative stereotypes and cultural mistakes. Now, when I think of my books, I simply write and illustrate my memories, my own lived experience in Syria and in Damascus. For example, my book, The Jasmine Sneeze, simply come from nostalgia because I wrote it after I moved here in the UK. I also illustrate a lot of fountains, courtyard and arches because the old city of Damascus is simply engraved in my memory. My stories often touch on the reality of refugees and the war in Syria. For example, my book Tomorrow, it's about a little boy named Yazan who lives in Syria during the wartime. Now, parents might ask themselves, why do I want to expose my children to these difficult realities like war and refugees? Now, I truly believe that children are not excluded of what's going on in the world around them. And by reading these books, it helps them build their empathy and understand the world better. Finally, I truly believe that all children deserve to see themselves in the stories they read, but not in the background, right at the center of the story, and in a way that they can recognize themselves.
Nadine, that was a really lovely video. What would be some of your practical tips on how to fight stereotypes when reading and writing literature?
It's really important to truly think when choosing this book that the character who is coming from an ethnic minority or the character of color, how empowered that character is. Because what's happening is, unfortunately, a lot of books are being published in the name of diversity and inclusion, in the name of representation. The characters don't have agency. They are kept in the background and unfortunately suffer from the white savior narrative. So what I would say, when you choose a book that you truly want to fight racism and you want to seek equalities in these books, the character of ethnic minorities need to be empowered, need to be strong, need to have agency, need to be added value to the story. Unfortunately, many stories now published about, for example, Syrian refugees, you find the Syrian refugee character is waiting for others to help. This character is not included in the story, but then yet they announce it as a story about a child refugee.
And just to bring in Ruth into that conversation, Ruth, you've spoken a lot about developing racial consciousness in children as a way of overcoming racial prejudice. How do you try and do that?
Yes, so one of the things that came to mind, actually, a lot of people were asking, what can parents do in order to raise this consciousness about racism, you know, in children, and also when is the right time to talk to children about race and all the other complex, you know, issues that we're facing at the moment. And my response is that it's never too early. So as soon as your child is able to communicate with you, you will find that there's a lot that they're picking up on, because primarily they learn by seeing. And one of the first things they learn is what their colors. So as soon as my son could, you know, identify different colors, he knew that he was brown looking. And he thought every other person that looked like mommy and daddy was related to us. So we had to start having that conversation very early, you know, explaining to him why, you know, people look different on the outside. We've got different colors, but we're all the same, essentially. And as he grows up, we're going to be supplementing that with, you know, age-appropriate information, but the important part is to keep that conversation going and not to shy away from it, because ultimately children will come across the wrong information about what it means to be of, you know, to look a certain way and look different. They'll come across negative connotations associated with race. And so this is why I think it's so important for all the adults in children's lives to equip themselves with tools and language to be able to actually explore these topics very early on with children. I believe the only way we can truly overcome racism and all the other ills in this world is through education, because children are like a blank, you know, they're like a blank sheet. Everything they become is through education and what we teach them. So we have to start with ourselves, equip ourselves, commit to, you know, independent investigation of, you know, the correct information out there, the right tools, the right language, you know, being exposed to diverse, you know, views. And so that we can then pass that on to our children, and our children can actually embrace the world that we're, you know, preparing them for, which is very diverse.
Thank you, Ruth. And also Nadine, for making really, really important points about the power of representation, and also why it's important for kids to have empowering narratives, which, Nadine, as you say, move away from sort of savior complexes. But we've now got a question from an audience, which I'm going to direct to you, Francesca. So Raquel asks, what is the role that teachers and schools play in offering and telling underrepresented stories to our kids? Should it be a public policy? What do you make of that, Francesca?
I think it should. I think it's very important that we take responsibility for the kind of stories that we tell children, because they actually inform the role that children believe they can have in the world. So the problem with the perpetrating stereotypes in the stories that we tell children, even in a public school setting, is that we are actively telling children who are absent from the narratives that we expose children to, that they don't have a role in our society. And that has huge implications in the policy in the politics. It has huge implications in the life of a country, and it, by the way, it will have even bigger implications when this pandemic in a post COVID world, because what we are seeing now, we are seeing it in Italy, but we're seeing it all around the world, is that the school remote schooling is really affecting the ability of children who come from more challenged families, who have less opportunities, who have less resources. It's really affecting their ability to follow and to keep being in their path, in their school path. And you know, if on top of this we don't take care of making them feel part of the world of the future by changing the kind of stories we tell them, we risk of having a vast part of the population that feels completely left out. And that has huge costs for our countries. It has huge costs for society, not just for these minorities. So even if you feel that you're not affected directly by these things, you actually are, because if we have a lot of people that feel completely left out, that usually doesn't turn out okay for everyone else.
You're completely right. The narratives that kids can be exposed to from a young age really can have a lasting impact on how they view the world going forward. So yeah, I completely agree with that, Francesca. We've got another question coming in, this time from Shruti on YouTube. They ask, many super big publications with huge followings are producing problematic content. How would the panelists stand against these giant publications and push their content forward? What do you make of that, Nadine?
It's actually one of the hardest things being a children's book author coming from an ethnic minority is to fight and struggle in this very rigid industry. So I'm really happy that this question is being asked, because it is a fight and it is a struggle. And if we think of the percentages, I mean, it's unbelievably, it's shocking that only 5% of children's books in the UK, for example, feature characters of colors, and only, I think, only 6% of authors in the UK come from an ethnic minority and authors of color. So it's very, very hard to get in, and you need to keep being together. So authors of ethnic minorities, they need to join together, have their voice raised, and fight this Western narrative that is being published. Because as you can see, a lot of books are being published about, for example, refugees, about characters and colors, but who's writing them? Writing them Western authors, not own voices, not authors who live those experiences, who have the true authentic voice for it. So to answer the question, it is a struggle, and we need to all stand together. And also parents, they need to be aware of this problem. And when they buy the book from the bookshelf, when they go to bookshops, they need to choose the right book.
Definitely. Yeah, just to pick up on the stat there, you're completely right. Just under 9% of children's authors and illustrators were people of color, according to Charity Book Trust in 2019.
If I can weigh in.
You want to come into that?
Yeah, please
you come in.
Yeah. So it is a very big struggle, because the vast majority of the traditional, of the big publishing houses, pay a lot of lip service to the need of more diverse books. But when it comes to publishing a different kind of books, they are very resistant to doing that. And that's one of the reasons why, in my case, I chose to be not just an author, but an entrepreneur as well. And it's where, you know, that's the reason why Good Night Stories for Rebel Girls was published by the company that I founded in the United States. And now I started another publishing company that is called Undercats, to keep publishing these books and to be braver in the kind of titles that we publish, because it's incredibly hard to push forward certain titles within the existing system. The problem is that usually traditional publishers rely on their set of data to understand if a title is going to sell or not. And they are not huge risk takers. the thing is that these industry and the, this need that is now emerging for diverse stories is completely new. So there isn't an existing data set to base your decision upon when you choose to publish a children's book, for example, about the gender identity exploration of a child. And there is a lot of resistance there. So there could be that the sentiment, the general sentiment that we hear is, you know, from publishers is that they want to publish this diverse content. But in my experience, more often than not, when put in front of content that is actually new, it's not very likely that they choose to publish it. And that is why I encourage, I use crowdfunding in my past several times. I run four Kickstarter campaigns to publish some of my books. And when I talk to authors that want to put out in the world innovative books, I recommend that they start building their own audience and that they find a way to push their idea through, even if they get no's from the big publishers out there. I believe it's a very fictional and very damaging idea that you are an author on only if you are published by a big publisher. Otherwise, you are an underdog. You don't deserve, you know, recognition. I believe that is a very damaging idea, and we should move away from that, because today there are so many ways to put your books out. You don't be snobbish. Just go and find your audience, because readers are everywhere, and it's very hard for big publishers to find readers that are, you know, setting a new standard for children's literature.
You know, Francesca, I mean, having to crowdfund, I mean, Goodnight with Stories, Rebel Girl has had a huge success, so, you know, you must be feeling really happy that you took that step. I want to take this moment also to welcome everyone around the world watching on YouTube, from India to the US, Italy and the UK. But also, I've got another question now from Gaia. Gaia on YouTube asks, and Ruth, this is one for you. What if your child is drawn towards a story in which female characters are stereotyped? I always see a lot of stories representing mean girls, and I'm very keen to bust the myth about female friendship. That's so true. What do you make of that, Ruth?
That's very interesting. So for starters, if that was a book that my child had come across from a different setting, say from school, then obviously I don't have much influence in them, you know, having that book in their hands. But what I can do is be proactive. Like I said, you have to be very mindful of the information that your children are coming into contact with. So all the books that they're reading, what they've been exposed to, you should be there to actually explain. So like we say, a lot of content out there isn't representative of all the children. So I take that as a teaching moment, and I'll explain to my son, you know, this is what this book is saying, but actually we know that in reality, you know, men and women are equal, or, you know, it's not a very nice thing to be mean to other people. So we talk about that. It just make sure that you take every opportunity to use that as a teaching moment. So as much as I'd love my son to also see himself in books, I also want him to be conscious about other people and, you know, different people. So I'm very eager to buy him books about girls, but girls in a positive light. I want him to see women in strong, you know, lead positions. Mm-hmm. I want him to see stories about fathers that normalize, you know, fatherhood being very connected to the home as well. That something that doesn't over glorify, you know, being a dad, as if it's truly something special to step up and look after your own child. So things like that, you have to really be present and have those conversations. So the learning has to be, you know, what's the reality and what do you want that message to be? So I would say just step in and then find those teaching moments wherever you see them.
And thinking about those teaching moments, Francesca, in Goodnight Stories for Rebel Girls, you try to show that real women could be heroines. What impact do you think that's had?
I'm sorry, say again? You broke up
so
a little.
In Goodnight Stories for Rebel Girls, you try to show that real women could be heroines. What impact do you think that's had?
It's been amazing to see, when I met readers around the world, to see the impact that the book has had on them. One, I remember fondly this little girl who told me about career day in elementary school. and she told the teacher that she wanted to be a surgeon when she grew up. And one of her classmates, a boy, told her, "You are a girl, you can't be a surgeon." And she just shrugged and she said, "You haven't read Goodnight Stories for Rebel Girls." And I really loved that reaction because she didn't let that comment get to her, because she had this example in her life through the book that there actually are female surgeons, and she just shrugged it off and she moved forward. So that is what I like to think this book has done for many little girls around the world, and it's the kind of stories that I want to keep on publishing with Undercats to widen the representation and make sure that as many children as possible can see themselves in this box and can shrug off comments that they will come across, because we don't live in an ideal world. But if they have a reference, if they know stories that prove the naysayers wrong, they will have antibodies to defend themselves and to be who they want to be.
No, that's a really strong message, so that little girls and also little boys can do anything and be anything. And now, just to round up a bit, Nadine, what would be some of your top tips to aspiring writers?
It's an interesting journey to become a writer, especially me coming from Syria, thinking that it's impossible to have my voice out there. It's impossible to get my book published, knowing that in the UK, very, very few coming from ethnic minority. And my advice will be to keep trying and believe in yourself, but also be an advocate. Be an advocate for this problem and be there for all the events and debut writers awards, and just put yourself out there in the market, and then you'll find your place. Also, another advice is just self-publish. So I know Francesca is doing crowdfunding and fighting the industry. And that's something, one of the things I did. I self-published my first book, Ansemi Layla, about a girl who has hearing difficulty, because I couldn't find a publisher for it. So I thought, this is it. I'm not going to wait. I'm going to self-publish it. And I was really happy that the first time I self-published a book, it won an award. So what I would say is, don't let publishers really undermine your work and make you believe that you can't have your book published or your work to be out there. Just keep trying.
It's so inspiring to see how all three of you have overcome so many obstacles to break into this industry, but also be really, really successful in what you're doing. And off the back of that, Ruth, what would be your advice and tips to aspiring writers? It was your children who influenced you to get into the industry in the first place.
Absolutely. So I would, much like everyone has said, is just to have confidence in yourself. Really think about why you want to do it. Like I said, my biggest motivation are my sons. You know, I'm doing this for them and their friends and the community at large. And I feel that nobody is going to be able to tell the stories that are within me except myself. So if I want to promote a certain narrative about, you know, equality of men and women, and I want it told from a certain perspective, only I can share that information. It would be such a it would be a great benefit to the wider society as well, seeing as we know that there isn't that much diverse content anyway. So write that book. If it's about your own cultural heritage, like I was born in Zambia, I'm living in the UK now, both my sons were born in the UK, they're only going to learn about their culture and their heritage if I, you know, pass that information on, and I can't find a book that talks about that. So I'm going to write that book. And another parent might want to, you know, share that book with their child to learn about our experience and our culture and our heritage. So absolutely, just do it. I self-published as well. If you're eager to learn and you're committed and you've got the time, we want to hear your stories. I would love to see more authentic, you know, voices and more diversity in the writers themselves, the illustrators themselves. It's absolutely necessary because there is, like I said, a huge gap, and you'd be doing humanity a huge service if we all can just make a contribution to that.
Thank you so much, Francesca, Nadine, and Ruth, for your time and for being here today and sharing your top tips.